Welcome to Authors Out Loud, a series of discussions with authors exploring their books, delving into the inspiration of their characters, themes, and stories, as well as discussing the craft of writing itself, the trials and victories they experience seeing their work to completion. I'm Susan Supak with my co-host, Jean Greenlaw. We're speaking with acclaimed author, Gregory Maguire. Gregory is the epitome of the explosive nature of a creative spirit. He burst into national fame with his novel, Wicked, The Life and Times of the Wicked Witch of the West, which was adapted into an award-winning Broadway musical seen by 60 million people worldwide and amassing over 5 billion, yes, that was with a B, billion in global sales.
This for like a year.
I think it's the best thing I've ever seen, to be honest.
Popular, I'll help you be popular. You'll hang with the right cohorts. You'll be good at sports. Know the slang you've got to know. So let's start, because you've got an awfully long way to go.
I think it's the best thing I've ever seen. This is my second time seeing it. And I already have tickets to come back and see it again. I love it.
It was the best.
Good news.
Some confusion, for you see, my roommate is unusually and exceedingly peculiar and altogether quite impossible to describe.
Blonde.
See you now.
But that is just part of Gregory's literary accomplishments. He is the writer of dozens of crossover books for adults and children, and an ardent supporter of the importance of literature in children's development. Welcome, Gregory.
Thank you so much. What a pleasure it is for me to be with both of you today.
It is an honor to have you here. I think that we have so many, many ways we could go, but I think the best way to go is to start with a quote from you. And I quote, "Wicked, at its heart, is not a book about the Wizard of Oz, but about how we contemplate and how we talk about evil and those we deem evil," end of quote. We grow up agreeing on very little, but just about everyone who can read or has watched television in their life has grown up knowing with absolute great certainty that the Wicked Witch of the West is evil through and through. You put that fact right on its head. You gave the Wicked Witch a name, Elphaba, and you gave her a heart. You gave her a humanity that causes us to question our lifelong judgments about her. We feel for her. We see her in an entirely new light based on our own experiences, actually, of being misunderstood or perhaps marginalized. Cahil Gibran writes, "For what is evil but good tortured by its own hunger and thirst?" Are you asking the same question in Wicked, Gregory?
Well, that is a great quote, I have to say. And the business about being tortured by one's own needs is, of course, the preliminary condition for being a writer anyway. So to think that all of our attributes are the result of appetites, the animal appetite for something, is a notion I hadn't thought about till just this minute. But in a way, yes, I am. What is evil but good tortured by its own hunger and thirst? Good does have a hunger to be recognized in the world, or at least to recognize what it can do. Maybe it doesn't need to be recognized for itself, but it needs to recognize, it needs to be able to recognize what it can do. And evil seems to me, one definition of it might be that evil is a result of when a certain appetite has been torqued, has been twisted, has been acted upon by other forces. To be less foggy, because I can be just as foggy as the San Francisco Bay Area, to be less foggy, I'll say that when I wrote Wicked, I didn't know much about evil. I didn't know what we meant when we said evil. So I started talking to friends and to family and to people at dinner parties and to people I knew who were religious and people who I knew who were avidly democratically secular and atheistic. And I would ask everybody, what is your conception of evil? How would you define it? Where does it originate? What is it actually? Is it an adjective that describes something else? Is it an entity in and of itself? If so, from whence did it originate and where does it reside? And you know, you can't get an answer to those questions. You can only get hypotheses as human beings consider different instances of what we might generally consider evil. For instance, it would be pretty hard for us not to agree right here that hurting a baby is evil. Hurting something defenseless is evil. And yet when we hear that maybe such a thing has happened, it is impossible for us not to try to parse our understanding into, well, was somebody sick? Was somebody clueless? Had somebody been acted upon by some other force and therefore was out of control? Is there a chromosomal imbalance? Was there a demonic possession? Had somebody been beaten up as a kid himself or herself? And so we immediately spin into different theories about how an evil act could come about because we don't know the answer. That's what makes writing about evil so very rewarding. Although reading about it, you come to the end of Wicked, which is 407 pages, and you say, do I know anything more than I used to know about evil? Well, I hope you might know a little bit more, but what you won't know is the answer to the questions I pose. What is its nature and where does it come from? Because I think that is essentially unknowable, and we have to learn to live with the fact that we can't define that.
Well, it's fascinating that with just these shifts of perspective that you've been discussing, you make us challenge our surface assessments. If we can be wrong about the Wicked Witch, maybe we can be wrong about a whole slew of other things that we're sitting and making judgments about. And, you know, the same way that Elphaba is not just a slice of evil with no desire for love or no good in her, she seeks forgiveness. She wonders, do I have a soul? You know, she has her own morality and she risks her own safety to defend others. She is no saint, but there is good in her. And it makes us wonder just how many other surface assessments we ought to be looking at in our own viewpoints. How would you respond to that?
I think it's true that if we don't start every day when we wake up, wherever we might wake up, whether it's in, you know, the Versailles Palace or in a gutter someplace, if we don't wake up every single day and ask ourselves the questions, who am I and what am I doing here? You know, if we wake up knowing too much about the world, we better go back to bed and get another 20 minutes because we should be waking up with questions of identity and questions of agency. That's the way to keep the most alive. It's the chiefest way of being engaged with life is to ask questions all the time. So, Jean, I completely agree with you that as we assess who is good and who is evil and come to snap judgments, which sometimes we need to do, like say in a moment of crisis, if, you know, we need to decide, are mm-hmm. we gonna jump in? And if so, on whose on whose side are we going to lend our fisticuffs or our $20 bill or whatever it is that we have for support. As we do that, sometimes we have to make snap judgments, but even after we make them, I think we're obliged to do a little reflection about what our behavior has meant and the ways in which it may have achieved something beyond which we hoped it to do. I'll give you a great example. This conundrum I face all the time, especially as a person raised in a certain tradition of charitable giving as I was. What do you do when you're walking down the street and somebody asks for a handout and you have a $20 bill in your pocket? I get thrown into a conundrum. My birth mother, who was very poor, would give away half her pay packet during the Depression before she got home. And the money was needed to feed her motherless brothers and sisters, because her mother had died when she was young. And yet she was a soft touch and she couldn't help handing out dollar bills off her pay packet as a waitress. You give somebody a $20 bill who's, you know, kind of panhandling at the train station, and do they have cirrhosis of the liver, and have you just handed them another four drinks that is going to impact their quality of life and their longevity on this planet? You can't know. So maybe you're charitable, but you can't avoid, I really do think you mustn't avoid at least asking the question, at least knowing that you're not certain. You have to live with uncertainty in order to take responsibility for your behavior.
Wow, that's so true. I mean, as you say, the answers are so tough. But your remark about reading through Wicked and the answer at the end, did you get to the answer of what's evil and saying no, but it really opened my mind to questions. And I think that's probably what you're saying in each answer is about our questioning and how important that is. I know, as we said, Elphaba's no saint. She really isn't. You read the beginning of the book and much of what she did was very antisocial and very not nice, but a lot of it was created by her being rejected and alienated because she was green. All right, fill in that blank with anything you want, because right, she right. was a blonde, because she was short, because she was whatever, right. whatever, you know, group that you're in. I mean, as a world, we do not like to accept what is unique. I mean, by and large. Now, right. there are works of art that are unique, but even them, I would say, a lot of them are rejected at first because they're different and people don't like them. Modern art, whatever the case may be, at least not at first. So instead of seeing the differences as enriching us, we often see it as, oh, if they're accepted, what am I going to lose? Not what am I going to gain? Now, we think that that's going to diminish us. That's going to diminish the normalcy we want all around us. What do you think right. about that?
Well, but, and I, oh boy, you, this is, these are great questions. I'm not going to be able to sleep tonight. You know, the question I have to ask, and I'm asking this rhetorically, is a question, are we so easily diminished that we can't share what we have and still retain the fullness of our selfedness? Can we possibly say, I don't think we are. I don't think we can be. How does it come to be that we think that we'll lose if we give over? How, I don't, that's a deep question that I don't have the answer for, but I don't think we are that weak that we can be so easily diminished that if we give credit, if we give a little room in society, if we give a little extra money, if we give whatever it is that we have to give, that we will somehow be less than ourselves. I don't think that's how it works, but that's certainly how we feel many times, whether we're kids or teenagers, the worst, you know, or young adults, only a little bit better, or us sage and wise people as we find ourselves at this stage.
Well, this would be a terrific time, if you would like to do this, is have you read a section of Wicked for us?
I would be delighted. I picked a section that I sometimes read when I'm in public, and it is purposely chosen because sometimes if I'm in a college audience or in a large auditorium, a lot of people in the room will know the story of Wicked through the play, but they won't know it through the book. And the while there are many, many similarities, there's a fatherly relationship of the book to the play. In actual fact, the tone is different and a lot of the plot is different. So I'd like to read a section in which some parts of our cultural memory of the Wizard of Oz film from 1939 can be brought into play. Almost everybody has seen that movie. And yet the new level of sobriety is also intact here. This scene has a 14-year-old boy named Lear, L-I-I-R, attending on the Wicked Witch of the West in the castle known as Kiamoko, out in the West. Now, Lear may be her son. She's not actually sure if she ever had children. In the musical, she didn't have any children, but this is the book, and maybe she did. Most people know whether or not they've had children. I mean, men sometimes don't, but women are usually pretty sure. But she's a witch, so how did this came to pass? You'll have to read the book. But anyway, here she is, a green-skinned witch stuck in a castle in the West of Oz with this 14-year-old boy who may or may not be her son. And this is the end of the story, so Dorothy is drawing near. One afternoon, a few weeks later, Lear came back from a ramble, all hot and bothered. The witch hated to hear that he had been hobnobbing again with those soldiers down in Red Windmill. They had news, a dispatch from the Emerald City, he said. A delegation of strangers got in to see the wizard, and one of them was just a girl. Dorothy, they called her, a girl from the other land. Ooh. The wizard hasn't allowed an audience with his subjects in years. He works through ministers, everybody says. A lot of soldiers think the old guy actually died a long time ago. In his absence, it's just a palace plot to safeguard the peace. But Dorothy and her friends got in and they saw him and they told everybody what it was like. Well, well, said the witch, imagine that. All of Oz, loyal and otherwise, is yapping about this Dorothy. What did the fools say next? The dispatch soldiers said that the guests asked the wizard to grant them some wishes. The scarecrow asked for a brain. Nick Chopper, the Tin Woodman, asked for a heart. And the cowardly lion asked for courage. And I suppose Dorothy asked for a shoehorn. Dorothy asked to be sent home. I hope she gets her wish. And? But Lear got coy. Oh, come on, I'm too old to be put off my supper by gossip, she snapped. Lear looked flushed with guilty pleasure. Soldiers said that the wizard had rejected their odd requests. And you're so very surprised. The wizard told Dorothy that he would grant them their wishes when they had. You haven't stuttered in years. Don't start again or I'll beat you. Dorothy and her friends have to come here and kill you, he finished. The soldier said it's because you murdered some old lady in Shiz, a famous old lady, and you're an assassin. Also, you're crazy, they said.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned in your prelude to reading to us that there are elements in the Broadway show that are different than are in the original book, Wicked. And in your book, Wicked, it's really a deep study of identity, of friendship and loss. How do you feel the changes that have been, what are some of the major changes in the Broadway show? And what's your response to those changes? And then what do you attribute the long running a popularity of the show?
Well, those are two different questions.
And yes, exactly.
I'll see if I can remember the second question by the time I finish answering.
But the
truth is, you asked what some of the differences are. The play, which I totally adore and love and have seen 60 and a half times, literally, the play compresses both the number of characters, the number of people in the chart of dramatis personae, and it compresses the amount of time in which the story actually takes place. You could imagine, you could see the whole play and think, well, this takes place, you know, within 12-month period between when she first goes up to college and when she and Fiero disappear. The book takes place over a 38-year period from the day that Elphaba is born as a little green-skinned witch until the day that Dorothy arrives with her baptismal splash of water. So a lot of the characters are different. The plot is able to follow the development of lots of characters' lives, to just like a soap opera, like a telenovela, to leave characters for 140 pages at a time and have them return and show up and in an ongoing comic strip or something, which is very gratifying as a writer and gratifying to a reader, I'd like to think. So that's one thing, is that the play develops the theme through a number of different characters, not just the character of the witch and the good witch, Glinda. But I do love it. I do love the play. And one of the reasons why I was only initially a little bit alarmed when I heard about how the last 3 minutes of the show would go, the bottom of Act Two. And I don't think it's giving much away at this point when so many people have seen the play, that in the last 3 minutes, it turns out that the witch's disappearance when Dorothy splashes her with a pail of water is a bit of trickery, and she pops up out of a trapdoor and she's still alive. First time I heard that's what they were going to do, I wasn't crazy about it, because it turned the story from a Shakespearean tragedy, which is what I had actually thought of it as being, into something slightly more Disneyfied, if we can use that as an adjective. And yet, Jean, as time went on and I watched audiences come to terms with that moment, now admittedly, parenthetical, first time it ever played to a paying audience in San Francisco, people booed at that moment. And they booed the second night and they booed the third night. And I know that because I was there all three nights. I was seeing it a lot the first week because I thought, well, if this doesn't make it, I want to be able to have a lot of memory of it. So I saw it every night for like five nights in a row. And by the fifth night, news must have gotten out, so people were less they objected less. I think they booed because A, they know what L. Frank Baum had said, B, they knew what the movie 1939 had done, and C, a lot of people in San Francisco were very familiar with my novel and knew, could tell what it was that I had been trying to do with it. So, however, why didn't I object more? It's this reason, Jean. I think that in Wicked, there are some important messages. One of them is that time is short in life. So we have to understand what we do really matters. We can't afford to be down-spirited. We can't afford to be cynical. We can't afford to be too absurdist. What we do actually does matter. And the third thing is, because time is short, it is urgent that we cherish the ones that we love while we have the chance. All those three are urgent messages that one should come away with at somebody's death. Even if I have a friend whose mother died 7 weeks shy of 105, really just last week. And even in her life, time was short at 104 and 10 and a half months. She cherished whom she loved, and what she did through her long life did matter. Those things are true at the end of her life, and they're true at the end of any of our lives. They're true at the end of the novel Wicked, and we get there through the agency of a tragic plot, that is, the witch dies. They're also true at the end of a play. They're true at the end of the musical Wicked, when Elphaba and Fiero walk off into the Badlands, as it were, and Glinda doesn't know that they're still alive, and she's never going to see them again. That's actually effectively a death. And the same meanings are imparted, that for Glinda right now, as she's hugging the Grimoire, she knows time is short. It's important that she does, that her actions matter. She's going to do the best she can. And she's going to cherish the memory of Elphaba and cherish those who are not dead while she has the time. Mm. So if we get to the same kind of terminus, it doesn't matter which rail track we take there, as long as we come away with the same message. So I made my peace with the changes in the plot, okay, and a little bit the characterization too, a little bit more easily than some of my more highfalutin friends would have said I should have done, but you know, we're all ourselves and that's me.
Well, they're two different mediums. One, you have 400 plus pages to tell the story, and one, you have 2 hours on the stage. So there's two different mediums. And so I will remind you of my second question. It's obvious that people love this play.
Best Broadway show ever.
Wicked.
Only Broadway show in Denver is Wicked, and I've already taken Sharon to see it 23 times.
What would you say if I told you that I got you a small part in Wicked?
Oh my gosh, this is on my bucket list.
Oh, oh my hey, God. How about this for an entrance, huh?
Cliff, what is Wicked?
Wicked is right.
Wicked.
Wicked!
Coming from Wicked.
It's Billy. We are about to tailgate before a performance of Wicked the Musical!
Yes, loathing, unadulterated loathing.
Linda, Madame Morrible, Flying Monkeys there. Can you tell me how I can get back to my bar?
We get to go backstage in my favorite Broadway musical, Wicked.
Come on with us.
Smile, buddy. We're on Broadway.
To what do you attribute its long life on Broadway?
Well, thank you for reminding me. Well, there are several things, and in a way it goes back to where Susan began. I mean, the superficial and easiest thing to say is that, as David Stone, one of the initial producers of the play said, we all have a little bit of Green Girl in us. And I think that's true. We all feel unique, but being seen to be unique just puts the icing on the cake, as it were. And we all have felt that, and maybe we all feel it every day. But the friendship between the outcast and the popular girl is adorable. And it is something that we also need to do. We all have a job to get over our preconceptions, and we all love friendship, don't we? I mean, from the time we're five, we love it. And it's you know, that when we're 100 and four and, you know, 8 months, we love it too. We love our friends. But I think there's something more than just the girlishness of the show or the greenishness of the show. And this is what Susan alluded to at the beginning. I think that the popularity of the play on Broadway is partly because we have been sort of circumscribed in a great deal of our cultural apparatus in my lifetime with the notion that it's kind of gauche and embarrassing to go on record as actually believing that there is such a thing as good and evil, as actually believing that doing good is an important manifestation of selfness, that we actually do have appetites to be good. We just also have a strong appetite not to talk about it or not to let it be known. That's socialization. I think it's kind of ugly myself, but even the Bible said, don't let the left hand know what the right hand is doing. Don't publicize your good actions, just do them. But I do believe that it's not easy to talk about the fact that when you wake up in the morning, just as you have to go to the bathroom and you have to have some water and you have to have some coffee, you also, I think, want to know you're going to try to do good during the day. You're going to try not to be bad. You're going to try to be more helpful than hindrance to the world at large. And I think that's something we generally don't have a language to talk about anymore. Kids have it when they're little, but it becomes mm-hmm. embarrassing. It becomes like having, you know, Velcro sneakers after you learn how to do knots and laces. You know, you don't want to be seen as having to go around the world in Velcro sneakers. You don't want to be seen as wanting to do good. How embarrassing. Oh, he's so immature. He really thinks he can do good. Well, you know what? Yes, I do think I can do good. I try to do it quietly. And I try to second guess myself because sometimes I'm wrong. But for me, I have a daily impulse. And sometimes for me, doing good is just being a better writer, trying to be as good a writer as I can be. That's my writing pen, is my shovel, my tool, my pickaxe, and my baking utensils.
Well, I have to agree with what you've said. And that's one of the great gifts of your books, Gregory, is that they touch on so many, many different points that we need to constantly be reminded of. And also, they open people up to discussion and discussing things that we might normally not talk about. Just in preparing for this interview, I have had some tremendously interesting discussions with my friends about evil. Now, what I would never have mentioned it if I hadn't gotten ready for this and it was on my mind and I'm expressing my thoughts. And I think that is such a gift to open up these conversations. It's quite wonderful.
Well, I'm really glad, and I'm quite a bit like both of you in that I read in order to make sure that my brain doesn't calcify and isn't just like a big bowl of, you know, marble in my head. You know, it has to be kept supple and it has to be kept on its toes. And every time I pick up a novel, I am forced to engage into a world I hadn't anticipated until the first page. That's good for the brain. It's good for the spirit. It's humbling and challenging. Sometimes it corrects you. Sometimes it confirms you. But it never leaves you alone if it's a good book, if it's well done.
Absolutely. Well, it's recently been announced that Wicked will be turned into not one movie, but two movies. And that the main characters have already been chosen, the people that will star in those roles. So lucky them. Will you have any input to the making of the movie? And where do you foresee them cutting that into the second part? And where do you see those movies ending and beginning?
I think that the movies are going to be follow the stage play pretty closely. That's my guess. I don't have any secret knowledge about this. Indeed, if you've read something about the making of the movies, you've probably read more than I do. I'm sort of like, to this project, I'm sort of like the distant grandfather who maybe struck oil about out in his tomato patch, but has been retired to the back porch with a rocking machine and a lifetime supply of Better Homes and Gardens, trying to figure out how to decorate the oil ring that's in the carrot patch. In other words, I'm trying to say I am not really kept in the loop about developments. So my guess is as good as yours or as bad as yours. We'll see where the guess is. But I think it would make sense to me that the two movies would break in half pretty much where the entr'acte falls in musical Wicked, which is to say when Elphaba finally comes into her powers and she rises flying for the first time in her life in her black skirts over the wizard's palace, and she sings, "No one's ever gonna bring me down."
And soon I now. And nobody in all of us, no wizard that there is or was, is ever gonna bring.
She's at the height of her powers, and she's at the height of her disengagement with the way the normal cycle of behavior in Oz has been predicted to run on its rails. In the second act, she is brought down. She's brought down by her own humanity, in a sense, by all the things that she can't do, that actually having good intentions isn't enough. Even having power isn't enough. You still have to take responsibility for the mistakes you make along the way. So the second act is a little bit more interior and a little bit more grown up too. It's what we get to after we've had our youthful breakout and we've severed ourselves from society, which is something that everybody does usually by 10th grade. And so I think that's where it will happen, but I don't have any say. I have been offered the script, the shooting script. The producer, I talked to him on the phone about a week ago or so, and he said, I'll send it to you. And I wrote back and said, you know, you don't really need to. I can wait. I don't need the ultrasound. I'll just wait to see what's born and I'll take it for what it is.
You are a very wise man. This is a real aside, but I noticed in reading Cress Watercress that the copyright is held by, and forgive me if I say it wrong, Kiamako, which is the castle that the Wicked Witch of the West was in when we did the reading. I think that's very interesting.
Well, that's it's a little sleight of hand recommended by various people I know who are concerned that their literary estates are kept intact for the benefit of their children after they go. So in recent years, I have begun to copyright, and I in fact have moved all my copyright ownerships away from me personally into a limited liability corporation. And that's really for the protection of the assets as well as the protection of my children.
And a well-chosen name. I love
that. Thank you. When I look at that, Chiamoco, I think, how did I come up with that? Well, in Italian, chiamo must mean who do I love? Or in some Latin language, chi is who in French, and amo amas amat, I love. Who do I love? Chiamo, co. I don't know about the co part, except that I did have a good friend named Yoko Kawashima Watkins, who was a Japanese woman living in Korea during the war. And her novel, her memoir, So Far from the Bamboo Grove, is about how she and her sister Ko flee during the war and how their mother dies as the three of them are fleeing, and how she has been her sister's protector and sole family member for the rest of their lives. And somehow the way she spoke about her sister Ko when I heard her speak was so appealing that I love that word, ko, and the way a Japanese woman might say it, ko, kiamo ko. So that's where kiamo ko comes from, I think, but I'm not really sure.
Okay. Well, we mentioned your book, Cress Watercress, which is a new children's young adult novel, beautifully crafted. And it's about loss. Particularly the loss of a parent and how one copes with the loss in their life. It's a theme that often runs through your books, that sense of loss in many different ways. This story touches with the various characters who move to a new build. Actually, I love the tree into which they moved and the many, many characters that one finds in that tree. So I know that though you are probably mostly known for your adult novels, those of us who find our true love in children's literature know that you're also extremely well known in the children's field of literature. And could many of us also feel, I keep telling people, don't avoid children's books. Children's books are for everyone. They give us all messages. And I would imagine that you probably feel the same way, that there are messages that touch everyone, not just children and young adults in those books that you write.
I completely agree. And in fact, very often, I'm not even sure if what I'm writing is for children or for adults until after it's done. In two of the last four books that I have published, I sent them off separately, one to an adult editor and the other to the editor of my children's books. And in each instance, I said, don't worry if you don't want this, I'll send it to my other editor. Meaning, either of you could publish this. I write for people who like to read Gregory Maguire books, and they can sort themselves out as to whether this one is for them or not. But I don't think there's very much difference. I will not, if I know something is expressly for children, there are some things I won't write about. I don't write very openly about sex in a book for children. I don't write openly about philosophy, but I certainly put it in there because we are all thinking beings. Even if we're rabbits, we're thinking rabbits. And I don't write openly about politics in books for the young either. But social life is political life, because social life means how to get along with the having and the not having, mm-hmm. that involves living in community. So there is politics. There's a political reality even to the underpinning of a story about animals living in an old dying tree mm-hmm. trunk. But you're right. Cress Watercress, if Candlewick had not wanted it, I would have sent it to my adult editor and said, what do you think? And I don't know what she would have said, but I think she would have given it a good think.
Right. Would you go ahead and read something from Cress Watercress
sure.
for us?
Now, it's going to sound, to anybody who has listened this far in this program, it's going to sound as if I'm always writing about nasty women, and who knows, maybe I'm deep down a misogynist that hasn't yet been self-identified. It would be kind of scary if that were the case at this late point in my life. But here's a section from early on. You're right, Jean, Cress Watercress is about loss. In this part of the book, which is only page 9, the mother rabbit and her two children have left their privately owned warren with a front door and a back door and a pantry and its own garbage patch and 3 rooms to move into a 1-room cold water garden apartment in an old dead tree. But they've lost the map, so they don't know where they're going. And now they're walking through the woods in the middle of the night. That's about as lost as you can be. Just then a figure crossed their path in the moonlight, striping the horizon with black and white. Oh, my pearls and pistols, what do we have here? Humble country folk out for an evening stroll? Asked a lady skunk, peering through a lorgnette. And far from home by the look of your shabby luggage. Good evening, madam, said Mama. The little ones are out late, said the skunk. I disapprove. Oh, do you? Said Mama blandly. Well, we can't be helped tonight. Not how I'd raise children if I had any, replied the skunk. But don't let me keep you. I'm off to the opera. Notice my lorgnette. Notice my chinchilla. Wrapped around the skunk's neck, the chinchilla shyly lifted her head and murmured, howdy do. Now, this is Lady Agatha Cabbage. And I don't know whether you can see this magnificent portrait. I'm sure she has it hanging above her mantelpiece by David Litchfield, Lady Agatha Cabbage. She's a skunk, both metaphorically and actually. She's a skunk.
She's one of my favorite characters. I can see her in a movie quite easily, or a Broadway show. And I would think she would be so fun. They'd be fighting each other to play her. I'd be like, no, I want to be her.
I think she would be delightful to watch too. All my characters, even in a shorter story. Now, Cress Watercress is only about 140 pages, if I remember correctly. Or maybe that's the typescript, but it's not very long. And the chapters are short, and there are color pictures on about every third page. It's really an extraordinary accomplishment of bookmaking, about if nothing else. But all my characters get a little bit larger and become a little bit more complicated in the course of the few weeks or months that the story takes place. And this is what we hope when we stick a 6-year-old in a first grade class, we hope they're going to change over the course of the first 4 months by Christmas. We hope the teacher's going to say, I've seen some real development even since September. That's what we hope for our kids. And that's also what we should hope and expect for characters in books, because that's why we're spending so much time with them. We need to see them change in order for us to be able to have a guess about how we might be changing too, or might need to change next.
Gregory, in the many, many forms that you've written, science fiction, fantasy, children's novels, adult novels, all the ones we've been talking about, they all seem to have people in crisis, living on the edge, and they manage to survive and they become stronger because of it. And one of the concepts in Cress Watercress that really struck me and reminded me of something I had read about in the past was the notion of something being enough. Cress's mother tells her that tomorrow is good enough. And it reminded me of a concept introduced by Donald Winnicott. He's a British pediatrician and psychoanalyst. And he observed that children actually benefited from parents when they failed them, when they failed them in manageable ways, when they were just good enough versus the perfect parent. So the child never has any crisis, no problems to settle for themselves. And they help to handle them. And I thought of that when I read the mother saying, tomorrow is good enough. I guess you could add to that idea that we're all good enough, even as green as we are, which is warts and all.
Well, we are all good enough, but we all have a ways to go. We all still have a ways to go. Madeline L'Engle said something, the author of A Wrinkle in Time, she said something a lot like with the Donald Winnicott thought. And she said in one of her memoirs, we learn as much from our parents' mistakes as we do from their successes. And therefore, I crown myself with laurels for having been a very good parent, giving my children a lot of mistakes from which they could learn.
Well, the follow-up book, The Brides of Maricourt, is your newest book, the newest book in print that you have. But you have currently created a unique mythology. I'm wondering what will be in the next book, the book that succeeds that. And I know that you have Greek ancestry. Could you talk a little bit about how that plays into your writing?
Yes. But however, Jean, I'm going to ask you to rephrase that question, because I missed one important word in the very last phrase you said. So I want to make sure that I answer the question that you're actually asking.
All right. The book has parts of Greek mythology in it. And I'm wondering how your own Greek heritage played into your putting this into this particular book.
Thank you very much. And I'm glad I asked, because I hadn't quite caught that. Yes, I am. I am partly Greek. My mother was a Greek immigrant as an infant, or she was born shortly after she arrived off the boat in 1917. And she died when I was born. She died giving birth to me. So I grew up with a sense that there was a mythic Greek history that we learned in fourth grade. And there is a mythic Greek history that is my personal origin story, very Dickensian, very sad, really. I was in an orphanage for a while before my father was able to get his act together and pull the family back into being. And then I had a happy and productive childhood despite that. But the notion that we have these great pasts that are our inheritances, even when we can't see them, or even when we forget to identify their attributes, is something with which we all live anyway. I think the same thing could be said of people who, I forget what I read about not too long ago, about that people in different parts of the country in the United States and different ancestries, that different strands of society have had historically different ways of keeping in touch with the notion of ancestral line. And some people have a lot more of it than others. The British, for instance, seem very, very dedicated to knowing, you know, who their great, 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 great grandparents were, if they can be known. immigrants very often had to leave their paperwork behind when they were fleeing the apartment in the middle of the night for which they couldn't pay the next week's rent. So a lot of people have very little knowledge except for one or two generations about what their backgrounds are. And I'm one of them. I know that I'm from Greece, 50% of my chromosomes. As 23andMe has even confirmed that. But I don't know much beyond that. That means Greece for me, like Oz in its time, is a great invitation to explore imaginatively because I don't have much concrete about it. I've been to Greece many times at this point in my life, and I speak a very little Greek, but I wanted to take what I loved about being in Greece, including feeling at home and including feeling a foreigner at exactly the same moment. I'm at home and I'm a stranger in my homeland. How odd that is. And I wanted to put that sense of foreignness into a book. So in the book, The Brides of Maricourt, which is the beginning of a second series of books with my Wicked characters, as it were, I have the granddaughter of Elphaba, the Wicked Witch of the West. I have the granddaughter crash landing on Elphaba's old broom on the shores of an island that looks quite a bit like someplace in ancient Greece or in ancient Rome or one of those other high classical or late classical cultures. And I'm able, Jean, to air all my appetite to go someplace and say, well, I'm not sure where this is, but I'm going to make it home because I'm going to make it be so visible that other people can be welcome here too. Hey, isn't that, did I just come up with a new definition of home? To take a place that you don't know and make it so true that other people can be welcome there too. How's that for a new definition for home? That's what I try to do in book writing, and that's what Greece has done for me too. So, The Brides of Maricourt. Yes, I know these are bad images, but there's The Brides of Maricourt. And if you squint or if you put your bifocals down at the right height on your nose, you can see that there is a kind of a Greek temple on the hillside behind Rain, the name of the Wicked Witch of the West's granddaughter.
And as you have the book in your hand, do you have a passage you'd like to read from that book?
A very short one. And this too is a passage with a female character, but it's told from the point of view of a man who lives in this land called Maricourt, and he's come to this island just to do some bookkeeping, some ordinary scut work, administrative variety. And he, although the green girl who crash landed there a few nights earlier is trying to hide, his dog named Kerr has sniffed her out in the olive grove. And so this is just a very short scene where he meets her and he sees her for the first time. Kerr, that's the dog, had a great gander or goose at bay and was closing in on the creature. This, despite the small dogs being dwarfed by the furious bird drawing itself up. Cut back, boy, back, shouted Lucicles. The company of brides, the younger ones, presumed to be upslope, were shouting and waving their hands at his dog to deter him from attack. Kerr, you thug, he shouted. He swooped down to collect the dog around the belly. Kerr gave him a nip before he recognized his owner and continued to growl with theatrical gusto. But he was shivering too, as if afraid of what he'd started. The goose backed up and quawked. Neutering is too good for that mutt. Then Lucicles came to his senses and saw that the two youngest brides were flanking a third, a foreigner, a green-skinned creature not yet 2 decades old, if he was a judge. She was a figure from myth and fairy legend. For a moment, he thought, the fathers of Maricourt abiding were wiser than they knew. This is a holy island after all. For the first time in his life, he passed out cold. Some people have that effect on other people.
Oh,
That's a great reading. I look forward to the sequel of that. That's an awesome book. And you kept me on the edge of my seat waiting for the next book. So,
oh, thank you.
Yes. Working hard at it.
Thank you. The next one is called The Oracle of Maricourt. And it will be out in the fall of 2022, The Oracle of Maricourt.
Perfect. Very soon. Looking forward to it. Now, you have said, Gregory, that during the horrors of 9/11, you picked up Tolkien's books again and found that it gave you hope. And I, like many other lovers of fantasy, novels written by Tolkien and C.S. Lewis became so much a part of me and how I chose to see the world. And to me, that's a great, great point of a story. Any good story is it does change us. Now, unfortunately, I'm not able to talk to Tolkien or C.S. Lewis, but I have the honor of interviewing you. So I just like to ask you, do the words that you create allow you to express these complex concepts that you hold? Or do you find that your stories are more a multifaceted way of asking deep questions? Does that make sense to you?
Yes, it's a good question. And I try very hard not to be binary. So I think both of the things that you propose are true. I don't think it's an either or situation. I think that I both hold questions in my mind as a way to begin a novel. The novel beginning Wicked was, the question beginning Wicked was about the nature of evil. It wasn't about how can I make money piggybacking off somebody else's story idea. I really did not know enough about what we mean when we talk about the fact of somebody being bad. I just didn't get it. And I felt, gee, I'm a grown up and I've been to college. This is kind of important, not to go around in fog about. But I also think it's important. And I think if I've done my work right, Susan, by the time I get to the end of a book, I rarely have come upon an answer to the question that I've posed. Perhaps what I've become is more comfortable in the fact that the question needs to be asked still. That by the time you get to the end of Wicked, if you feel now I know everything there is to know, then I haven't done my job right. I want to leave you with more questions than you started with. But I want you to have been able to think and spend time with questions while you've been reading, even if mostly what's happening is subconscious. And I think most of us, when we read fiction, we're reading for plot, we're reading for activity, we're reading for what Steven Spielberg can get in his camera. But underneath, the meanings of why things happen the way they are urgently affecting us, I believe. And we come out with a deeper set of questions that one hopes will continue to inform our vigorous engagement with our own lives in the hours and days and weeks to follow.
You have another wonderful quote. You say that we all have one thing in common. We come from the culture of childhood and yearn for a story that will unriddle the world for us. Of your many books, which ones do you feel you succeeded most in that? And which ones are most important to you? Which ones helped you unriddle the world?
Well, I never turn to my own books for unriddling the world. That's what Emily Dickinson is for. and Frank O'Hara and Walt Whitman and Keats. And novelists as well. But if I really feel like I'm in deep trouble, I go to the strong medicine. I go to the poetry. Poetry is like extra strength Tylenol. It gets to what ails you fast if it doesn't kill you. You don't overdose on it. You have to be careful. You also have to be careful of these metaphors. But as to books, I've noticed something in the course of, let's say, books that I've written in the last 10 years. And that is that I don't exclusively write about girl children or about young women or women, but I'd say my protagonists are slightly more heavily weighted toward being female than toward being male. But in the last 10 years, almost all my protagonists have had something seriously wrong with them. Now, Cress, the only thing that's wrong with Cress is she's very young. She's a rabbit. She's a rabbit who's half a toddler and half a teenager, which is really how most of us are if we've if we admitted it, half toddler, half teenager. But in Cress, you know, she really is. Sometimes she sucks her thumb. Other times she disobeys her mother and goes out without permission. In my book, A Wild Winter Swan, the character Laura, a granddaughter of old Italian immigrant food importers, is a little bit cognitively compromised, let's say. Just a little bit, but enough so that she wears an innocence about her that would make her, would make it dangerous for her to move about on the street alone. But she lives in New York and it's 1963, so she is out on the street alone. In my book, Hidden Sea, which is subtitled A Tale of the Once and Future Nutcracker, I go into the life of Godfather Drosselmeyer, starting just as I did with Elphaba, starting with when he's born or when what his first memories as a young child in the woods, in the Bavarian woods, and ending up with his making the Nutcracker and the fairy tale theater for his goddaughter, Clara. And in the course of that story, Godfather Drosselmeyer in the 19th century pre-Germany, German states, if you will, is himself compromised emotionally. He can't form strong emotional connections. He's smart, he's traveled, he has languages, he has skill in his fingers to be able to whittle toys, but he is socially aloof for reasons he doesn't understand. And I don't know about the two of you wonderful, competent ladies, but most of the rest of people I've ever met in my decades on the planet have something that they struggle with, some sort of thing that makes them unhappy, some sort of question they've never been able adequately to answer. And yet you must, and we must, we all must put our feet one in front of the other and keep walking forward through our obligations and through the possibilities of joy that life affords us. So in the question about which of the books speaks to me and makes me feel as if I'm offering or answering a challenge, I think I'm offering challenges all the time. And when I come away from my books, I think we're all in this together. Cress Watercress and me, we're like soulmates. You know, I used to say that about Joni Mitchell and me, but now I say it about my own character. Elphaba and I, Elphaba, c'est moi. Elphaba Throb, c'est moi.
What? Jean mentioned this earlier, and I'm going to bring it up again in for the chance that perhaps you might have something else to add about the fact that in the mini novels you write, both for children and adults, regardless of what they are, even in the exploration of evil, when you were exploring the theme of the development of evil because of a loss of acceptance and affection, it spoke to loss. It spoke to loss being a critical part of our development, a critical part of who we are, why we are. You just mentioned it even in the last answer that you gave. So I'm wondering, why is this a prevalent theme in your stories? Is there any particular reason, or is it just something you find that is so universal, it's important to mention it in all your writings?
Well, I suspect that I began to notice how universal loss is because of the facts of my origins about which I spoke earlier. My happy childhood memories don't include any time in the orphanage. They don't include the grief and suffering experienced by my father when his wife died. They don't include the stories of angst when all his other three children were parceled out to family members for a number of months or years while he tried to survive a heart attack and see whether he would ever be well enough to pull the family back together again. All my memories are Ozzie and Harriet type, or let's say the Ozzie and Harriet family, if you can cut them with the Von Trapp family, because we were deeply and intensely Catholic family growing up in upstate New York. And I was not aware of the ways in which we were fiscally on the edge. You know, we were lower middle class. We were not deprived, but we didn't have extra. We didn't have extra money for clothes. We wore hand-me-downs. my mother, my second mother who raised me, bought food at the secondhand bakery, and we drank powdered milk, and she cut all our hair with clippers that she bought for $17.95 at Kresge's. All five boys, we had to stand in line in the laundry, and she would do all our left sides. Then we'd all have to pivot. She'd do all our right sides. And there were many ways in which we did not grow up in the lap of comfort. But what we did have, in addition to this sense that the family life had been broken halfway through when I was born, what we did have instead of money and a certain kind of arrogance that comes from comfort, we had the blissful passport of the library card. And my parents were both very anxious people. My father particularly, he was probably anxious before his wife died, but after she died, the notion that anybody else in his circle would die, it just drove him mad. And so I used to say to kids, you think your parents are mean? You think your parents are mean? Let's have a competition. My parents were so mean, we couldn't ride bicycles until we were 16 and had passed the New York State driver's license exam for automobiles. And that's the truth. My parents wouldn't let us ride two-wheeler bikes for fear that we would get killed. We had to know the rules of the road by taking driver ed before we could ride a bike. But they did not say you can't read from adult poetry. They didn't say you can't read Nabokov if you got out Lolita because somebody said it was a good book. I want you to talk to us about it after you finish reading it. But yeah, go ahead and read it. They did not curtail the liberties of our minds. And therefore, I dare say, they gave me the best beginning, the best springboard, the best foundation, the best comfort, consolation, and challenge that anybody should ever be able to hope to expect. All the great minds who write and put books in libraries were there as my tutors, my friends, my teachers, my spiritual guides.
I love that statement you just made. They did not curtail the liberties of our minds. Yeah. You know, not only are you so well known in the adult field, but your passion for children's literature is very well known. You got your master's degree at Simmons College, which is very well known for the field of children's literature. And you are co-founder of the New England, the co-founder of the New England Children's Literature New England, which I happen to be a Facebook member of. Anyone can join and find out what is the latest in children's literature. And for 25 years, you were co-director, not only the founder, but co-director of that. Talk about your passion for spreading children's literature, not just your own books, but that whole field of children's literature.
You know, it is a passion, and it's the only other thing I've done with as much dedication as I have done trying to harvest the fecundity of my imagination. I have such a conviction that whatever mental health I can lay claim to is thanks to those therapists who wrote children's books, thanks to L. Frank Baum, and thanks to J.M. Barrie and Lewis Carroll, and Madeleine L'Engle and E.B. White and all the great fantasists. And also thanks to Louise Fitzhugh, who wrote Harriet the Spy. She's the one non-fantasist writer who was always at the top of my list as well. Thanks to them, I was given the tools and the keys with which to unlock the riddles of the world and with which to survive a childhood that actually was harsher underneath its surface comfort. I realized as I became older that I did bear a terrible burden of guilt for having been the cause of the death of my father's beloved wife and my sibling's beloved mother and my own mother, unbeloved because I didn't know her. That I have carried that through my life. I don't carry it the same way now that I'm much older, but for a good part of the younger part of my life, I would ask myself the question, how did I get not to be as much of a nutcase as I am? I'm pretty functional. That's kind of an accident. It actually isn't supposed to work like that. It's an aberration. What was different for me? And there were several things that were different. One, of course, is even if there were stresses and strains and sadnesses in my life, I did have good parents. I had a good stepmother and a good father, and they were they were saddled with 1950s era constraints, but they were still dedicated, and they saw their job through to the end of their lives. And I also had that wonderful library with all the books and all the authors telling me, you can fly out the window of your nursery and go someplace else in your mind and come back, and you can be larger. You can be larger even than the people who are sleeping in the bed next to you actually know. That's what reading did for me. And I decided pretty much when I was in college, I thought, well, I could be a minister. I had some impulse toward being a church person. I thought I could be a doctor. I'm cautious about people's health. On the other hand, I don't want to ruin anybody's health. So what can I do that's not medical practice and not missionary practice? Well, I can use my imagination. That's actually a skill that I've been using all through childhood anyway. And maybe if I can make the lives of a few kids who are slightly bereft a little better, maybe if I can give them something to hold onto until the next lifeline comes their way, well, I will, at the end of my life, I hope I'll be able to say, you didn't just doggy paddle. You didn't just stay in one place in your life. You tried to use what little strength ambition had been given you to do something good for other people using the limited skills you have, which are the skills of storytelling and the skills of speaking in sentences that go on far too long.
Well, you've certainly accomplished all those things. Although
I
am not addressing the sentences too long because I'm not agreeing there with you on that. I want to get that on the record. But Cassie and I, at the future, our last question involves what your plans might be. Do you have any aspirations to become a playwright yourself and turn one of your books into a play? Or if you did that, you know, what might you do? So what are your plans, Gregory?
Well, you know, do you remember C.S. Lewis once wrote about how he got the idea for Narnia? He said it really was a single image. I don't know if it was a waking image or he was just falling asleep or waking up. And he saw the image of a lamppost in the snow and in a heavy forest, a lamppost in a forest where there should be no lamppost because it's not a road, and a fawn walked by, a fawn from classical mythology. And that was the first inkling he had that there was a world called Narnia out there. And he had to follow the fawn and see where it led. I think my ideas very often come like that. Marie Sendak, who was a dear friend of mine, Where the Wild Things Are and all that, used to talk about sinking the bucket and seeing what subconscious would have on offer. And so, Susan, I sink the bucket all the time. And lots of times what comes up is just an image and I kind of live with it and think, well, what does this happen? What does this mean? And is this going to find its way into a book? But Susan, when you say, what is it that's next? Once or twice in the last few years, when my mind has run over to you know, the open stage and thought, well, you know, who's at the mic next? People, come on, we're losing time here. Sometimes I have actually seen a glimpse of people on stage and a little bit about a setting. And I don't know if it's, actually ever gonna turn into a play, but I think that might be how plays begin, is when you can actually not have the idea, but see, okay, people move on. Somebody comes on here, somebody comes on there, and they start saying this. Wow, what's that about? That's all I have. I just have the impulse that I might be beginning a new capacity to hear people speaking in dialogue form. That's a slightly different way than hearing them speak in dialogue when you're writing a novel.
Interesting. Well, I look forward to whatever it is you have in mind in store for us for the future, because I'm sure it's going to be very grand. And we cannot thank you enough for taking the time to share your thoughts, your creativity, and your darling personality with us. Well, thank you so much.
You're very welcome. It's been a real pleasure. I know we've all had to work with some considerable considerable tenacity in order to figure out how to make this work and in order to get it scheduled, and I'll be ready to do it. And here we are. And it has been worth every minute of fuss about how to make it work, because I've had a great time.
Thank you. Thank you so much.